Good evening, everyone. Welcome back to Yoga Scholars PJMER. So today we are going to introduce you to a very special guest, Dr. Ramesh Bijlani. He's a medical doctor, scientist, writer, inspirational speaker, and a spiritual seeker. Above all these designations, he is a person committed to using his unique blend of talents for touching the hearts and his fellow being. He was a faculty in All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, for the last 30 years, where he did research on nutrition. And in 2000, he went on to establish a patient care facility for providing lifestyle modification courses based on yoga or prevention and management of chronic diseases. He took voluntary retirement from AIIMS in 2005 to find more time to disseminate on yoga. He has written 26 books, and he has his own website naming Speaking Tree, on which he have posted more than 250 blogs. And he's working at Sri Aurobindo Ashram, Delhi branch since 2007, where he conducts spiritual retreats, yoga courses, and gives talks. And he has continued his writing, and we welcome you, sir, and he will share his thoughts today with you all, guys. So over to you, sir. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Vita. Om Tatsavitur Varam Rupam Jyoti Parasya Dhimahi Yanna Satyena Deepayet. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Namaskar, my dear brothers and sisters. It's a great privilege to have this opportunity, courtesy Yoga Scholars of PGI Chandigarh, to talk to all of you. And thanks to technology, which has got a boost because of the COVID crisis, it has become so easy sitting wherever we are to interact with all of you, no matter where in the country or the world you are sitting. So it's a great privilege. And without spending much time, I'll go to the slides now.
Slides are visible, sir. Yeah.
Okay. So the title is Yoga Activates the Doctor Within. Now, trust me, the best doctor and the best pharmacy resides within the body. This is something the doctors have known for a long time, irrespective of which stream of medicine they belong to and which country they have been in. Doctors generally pray before they start operating. So many doctors, you know, are known to have put in their chambers notices or sort of posters like, I treat, God cures. And who is that God? God within us, who has given us all those mechanisms which treat us. And the best pharmacy also. Some of the most potent painkillers like opium have compounds very similar within the body, the encephaloids. And these encephalines are, unlike the opium and other such analgesics, non-addicting. And so the best doctor and the best pharmacy, in fact, resides within us. But then it does not do its best most of the time because we don't provide this doctor within the right conditions. And that's what yoga does. It provides those conditions under which it can work. Before I go further, I would like to use this opportunity to bring to all of you the blessings and love of the mother and Sri Aurobindo from Sri Aurobindo Ashram, Delhi branch. Now you say, what is yoga? Is that a beginning? Once more, ek baar phir wohi shuru ho gaye. But then, you know, anyone who speaks on yoga has this weakness. He wants to talk about it his way, and I'm not above that weakness. But I'll not take very long on saying my way what yoga is. Yoga, of course, is asanas, pranayama, and meditation. These are the techniques with which yoga is commonly identified. But then what can these techniques do? Asanas primarily improve the performance of the body, meditation that of the mind, and pranayama being the bridge between the body and the mind, may be able to improve the function of both the body and the mind. Now, this is only a rough and approximate way of putting it. In fact, you cannot really separate the body from the mind. Asanas would help the function of the mind, just as meditation would also improve the function of the body. But then put together, these techniques basically improve the function of the body and the mind. But what are the body and the mind? The body and the mind are our instruments. And the instruments, of course, should be sharpened. They should work better. But that is generally not enough. For example, a knife is also an instrument. With the same knife, one may chop fruits and vegetables. And with the same knife, one can also stab somebody. In the same way, suppose somebody has used these techniques of yoga to improve the function of the body and the mind, he'll make a better teacher, a better doctor, a better engineer, a better scientist, a better manager, because no matter what we do, we use our body and mind as the basic instruments. And if the instruments are functioning better, the person can do all these things much better. But then ponder over one simple question. Suppose there is a terrorist who is physically unfit, emotionally unstable, and intellectually dull. Will he be able to launch a successful terrorist attack? No, he won't be able to. He will fail. So, if he also uses these techniques to improve the function of the body and the mind, he improves his chances of becoming a successful terrorist. Now, if a discipline helps a teacher as much as it helps a terrorist, it cannot be called a spiritual discipline. But yoga is a spiritual discipline. So what is it that makes yoga a spiritual discipline? What makes yoga a spiritual discipline is the fact that it not only improves the function of the body and the mind, it also has guidance available on how to use the instruments. And that is what completes yoga. So to put it sort of mathematically, yoga is a set of techniques like asanas, pranayama, and meditation, plus guidance on how to use the body and the mind. Let's take an example. Suppose there's a building on fire, and there's a fireman in front of it. He has been told that there are a few people trapped inside the building. He at once gets an impulse, let me enter the building and rescue them, let me bring them out. But then before he does it, he may start thinking, but it will be very hot and suffocating inside. And then he may think, besides, it will also be risky. Suppose I die, what will happen to my family? Now you can see here, there are three different types of voices coming from within at work. One is the voice that tells him it will be hot and suffocating, which means it will be an unpleasant experience. So this is the voice of the emotional part of the being. The second voice is telling him it will be risky. What will happen to my family if I die? This is the voice of reason. But then what about that first impulse that he got? Let me go in and rescue these people. Where did that come from? That is what we generally call our inner voice. A faint, shy whisper within, but then which tells us in no unclear terms, extremely clearly and precisely, what is the right thing to do. In other words, for making various choices in life, we use these three tools, the feelings, which told this fireman it will be hot and suffocating, reason, which told him that it will be risky, and this inner voice, which told him, go in, rescue these people, without going into any further analysis or reasons, just this is right and this is wrong. Now, you would have made out by now that the type of guidance that yoga provides is based on this inner voice. And what is the source of this inner voice? What is the source of this guidance which comes from this inner voice? That source of the guidance is our soul. In other words, yoga takes into account not just the body and the mind, but also the soul. And what we have ended up doing is talking about the totality of the person, which is not just the body, the emotional part of the being and the intellect, the emotional part of the being and the intellect together being the mind. So it's not just the body and the mind. We also have a soul, and the soul is not there just to provide us the consolation that some bit of us will at least continue to be alive even after we are dead and gone. The soul also has a dynamic aspect which participates in day-to-day life and which provides us guidance. And this is the guidance that yoga depends upon. And this dynamic aspect of the soul, which can guide us when we have to make a choice, is the psychic being. That's what Sri Aurobindo and the mother have called it. So the psychic being is nothing but an aspect of the soul which is dynamic in nature and participates in day-to-day life. Now you may say, well, that is the type of guidance yoga provides, but why should I make those choices? What do I get from such choices? Now, if you go back to that example of the fireman, imagine the scenario in which, in spite of the fact that it is hot and suffocating and it's risky, he enters the building. Then, irrespective of the outcome, whether he's able to rescue people or not, irrespective of the outcome, how does he feel? He feels extremely good. He feels a sense of immense joy, and he has lasting mental peace. I did my best. In contrast, suppose he does not enter the building. He succumbs to those feelings of hot and suffocating and risky and so on. Then how does he feel? He feels guilty. And suppose later on it is found that a few people did actually die inside the building. He feels very uneasy, and this uneasiness may continue for a long time. It may keep coming up in his mind again and again for weeks, months, years, maybe throughout his life. So by making those choices, what we get, the choices which come from the soul, the type of guidance that yoga provides, by making use of that guidance, what we get is immense joy and lasting mental peace, and we escape the punishment of guilt and recurrent uneasiness. So this guidance which comes from within is coupled with a reward and punishment system. Listening to this guidance, acting on this voice from within, gives us the reward of immense joy and lasting mental peace, and ignoring it leads to guilt and recurrent uneasiness. Do we get anything else by making these choices? We get control over our happiness. Now, the type of choices that this inner voice or the psychic being of the soul gives us generally involve giving something. And giving is always in our hands. You know, they're based on love. And love can be expressed by giving. The fireman can express it by entering the burning building and trying to rescue these people. So that is his way of giving something to these people. Now, giving is always in our own hands. Getting is not. We can always love somebody. We can't force anybody to love us. So not only this joy, which comes from listening to this voice, is much better than ordinary happiness, say the happiness which comes from getting a new dress or getting a new phone. Not only it's much better than that, and that's why we don't call it just happiness, we call it joy. The happiness which comes from getting something is not always in our own hands, because nobody can get everything that the person wants. But the joy of giving is something which is always in our own hands. So why not get a superior version of happiness, which is called joy, and over which we have total control? So this places our happiness, our well-being in our own hands. Do we get anything else? Absence of conflict. Conflict between what? Conflict between the emotional part of the being, the intellect and the soul. We saw that in case of the fireman, there was a conflict, but then that conflict is not inevitable. Suppose a person starts listening to this inner voice, the voice of the soul, more and more frequently. What happens is gradually the emotional part of the being and the intellect, they get trained, they get influenced, they get modified, so that they get into the habit of working in light of the soul. And that's very easy, because after all, what is the emotional part of the being looking for? It is looking for happiness. And when it finds that by listening to this voice of the soul, one gets a superior version of happiness, which is always in our own hands. Why not? So the emotional part of the being learns this and as a result starts speaking in the same language as the soul. And once the emotional part of the being has done that, the intellect can easily fall in line because the intellect is very versatile. It can justify whatever we want. So once the emotional part of the being speaks in the same language as the soul, the intellect quickly finds a few reasons to support that choice. So if the emotional part of the being and the intellect and the soul are speaking in the same voice, there's no conflict. As in other words, the person has become soul-minded. Now, what is soul? The soul is the divine within, or Krishna within. As Lord Krishna tells Arjun in the Gita, man mana bhava, be my minded. Now, be my minded means have the same type of mind as Krishna, as the divine, as God. And how does that happen? That happens as a result of a transformation of the emotional part of the being and the intellect. Now, this transformation is not a one-time event. It will not happen suddenly. This conflict will not disappear all at once, in one step, but it's a process. And the process begins with our paying attention to this inner voice, following the type of guidance which yoga tells us to honor. And when we follow that guidance, gradually this conflict starts reducing. As conflict starts reducing, we start feeling more and more happy. Now, all these things, immense joy, lasting mental peace, escaping guilt and recurrent uneasiness, control over our happiness, and absence of conflict. What does it translate into? In short, it translates into good mental health. Now, to keep this in mind, that by following the type of guidance that yoga tells us to honor, we get good mental health. And what this has got to do with health as a whole, we'll return to in a few minutes. Now, some of the recent discoveries of modern medicine, not discoveries, rather rediscoveries, because these are things which have been known for a long time. We forget them sometimes, you know, for various reasons, and they go out of fashion, but then we keep rediscovering them. And modern medicine has once again rediscovered that we have very potent self-healing mechanisms within the body. Now, when I was a medical student, the usual thinking was that self-healing is possible only in case of diseases such as common cold and diarrhea and so on. But now we know that self-healing mechanisms exist also for chronic degenerative diseases like diabetes and coronary artery disease. So we have very important self-healing mechanisms for just about every condition. But the only thing is that these self-healing mechanisms need the best conditions to work. And one of the prerequisites for these mechanisms to work properly is that the mind should be at peace. There's a mind-body relationship of which there can be many aspects. One is, of course, that the patient should have the confidence in these self-healing mechanisms. But apart from that, the person should also be at peace. The mind-body relationship now is beyond hearsay or folk wisdom. It has been placed on a very scientific footing by a science which has developed over the last 40, 50 years, the science which we call psychoneuroimmunology, PNI for short. And what this science has now shown us is that you can demonstrate a clear link between the psychological state and the immune status of the person or the immunocompetence of the person. When we are cheerful and happy, our immune system works very well. It improves. And when we are under chronic stress, we are unhappy, then the immune system becomes weak. So there's a clear mind-body relationship. And this relationship affects the immune system. But an immune system, of course, is an important system in prevention of disease and in self-healing mechanisms. But then whatever mechanisms are there besides the immune mechanisms in self-healing also seem to be influenced by this mind-body relationship. So we saw a moment ago that the guidance provided by yoga helps us in having good mental health. So because of this mind-body relationship, helping us have a better immune system when we are at peace, when we have good mental health, and getting the best out of self-healing mechanisms. This translates into good mental health, translates into good physical health. So we really cannot separate the body from the mind. If the mind is at peace, the body is also healthy. As the mother has said, establish a greater peace and quietness in your body that will give you the strength to resist attacks of illness. So the body and the mind are closely related. Body stilling, as we do in asanas, helps in making the mind quiet. When the mind is quiet, it makes the body healthy and at peace. So when the body and the mind are at peace, we have the strength to resist attacks of illness. Somebody may say, well, I'll use only one half, which means now I understood the whole thing. There's a clear mind-body relationship. From tomorrow, I've decided to be happy all the time. I will not worry about anything, but I'm not interested in all this soul and divine and all this stuff. I am a pretty good person as I am. I do my job honestly in the office, and I pay my taxes. I look after my family quite well. I also give some money in charity. So I think that is good enough. Why should I bother about God and this and that and so on? And now I understood to be healthy, I also have to be happy. So from tomorrow, I'll be a happy person. I'll stop worrying about anything. Will it work? It won't. Why? Because just because this person does an honest job in the office does not prevent somebody else who doesn't work equally honestly from getting a promotion before this person. That person may supersede him. The person who may become his boss may be the one who doesn't work as well as he does. He may be paying all his taxes, but then that does not prevent the income tax department from calling him to quiz him on some minor points. Further, his being a good person in every way, as I said, does not make him immune to a road accident or to a failed marriage or to an incurable illness. Now, in all these situations, apart from the fact that just being a good person doesn't mean that he will not have the usual weaknesses which may make him not so good sometimes. That apart, just being a good person does not make him immune to the ups and downs of life, to the problems and difficulties of life. And for dealing with those, the guidance provided by yoga is important, because yoga provides us guidance. We saw only one aspect of it, not only in making choices, but also the type of attitude we should have to work, the karma yoga attitude. It also tells us how we should look at the ups and downs of life, as the Gita tells us, vijay or parajay, victory and defeat, cold and heat, insult and praise. How to deal with all of these, how to face all these with equal delight. That is what samatva is, samatvam yoga uchyate. So without yoga, the person, just by being a good person, will not be able to keep the mind at peace. So just by deciding that, well, I am not interested in all this soul and God and all this yoga stuff, I've learned mind-body relationship is important. From tomorrow, I'll be a happy person. I'll not worry about anything. That will not work, because the mind, by its very nature, cannot stay at peace, no matter how good the person is. The mind is, you know, like always in a perpetual storm. And as you know, the ship in the storm cannot really keep itself intact. It needs an anchor. It needs at the shore something to which it is tied. In the same way, the mind also needs an anchor. The mind needs a reference point. Mind needs something which is always at peace, as compared to the mind which is always in a turmoil. You know, the Gita, Lord Krishna concedes that yes, it is extremely difficult to control the mind. And then he goes on to tell him how to control it, tells Arjuna how to control it. So the mind needs an anchor. And the anchor for the mind is the soul. The anchor is the soul. You're all familiar with this, as practitioners of yoga and students of yoga of this shloka. Sarve bhavantu sukhinaha, sarve santu niramaya, sarve bhadrani pashyantu, ma kashchit dukkha bhag bhavet. Now, if you see this carefully, sarve bhavantu sukhina, let everybody be comfortable and happy. Sarve santu niramaya, let everybody be free from disease. Ma kashchit dukkha bhag bhavet, let nobody have in the slightest bit of sorrow. So being happy, having no disease, having no sorrow are quite similar. Not exactly the same, but similar. But the third line, sarve bhadrani pashyantu, stands out. It is quite different. Why has this third line been put there? Why this focus on seeing the divine, on seeing the most auspicious, which is the divine or God? Why being aware of that all the time? Because if that happens, the other three will follow automatically. Because if that happens, sarve bhadrani pashyantu happens, the mind will be at peace. And when the mind is at peace, it will be happy irrespective of external circumstances. The chances of getting a disease will go down and nothing will be able to make the person dukhi. So, ma kashchit dukkha bhag bhavet. So, all those three things will happen if sarve bhadrani pashyantu is satisfied. So, there is no alternative but to anchoring this unruly mind to the soul for getting mental peace. So the doctor is in, but she needs peace of mind. She needs a peaceful environment to do her best. And we have to provide that. And for providing that, there's nothing better than yoga. Well, you might say that there are so many studies available in which all this has not been taken into account. People do some asanas, at the most a few pranayamas, maybe sometimes meditation. And these studies have shown, some studies which have just done only focused only on a few asanas, they have also shown that patients with hypertension, heart disease, back pain, headache, migraine, and osteoarthritis, and so on and so forth, bronchial asthma, and all these patients do much better after doing these asanas. Yes, they do, but if so little of yoga can do so much, you can imagine how much more we can get if we take into account all the aspects of yoga. What we will get when we use all the aspects of yoga is reflected in this quote from Sri Aurobindo, unappalled by the fear of death. Can you leave to him, not as an experiment, with a calm and entire faith, thy ailments? So, can you not leave all your diseases, the worry about all your diseases, to God? To him means God, him with a capital, but not as an experiment, not just to try, ye bhi dekh lete hain karke, not that way, but with a calm and entire faith. Can you not leave your ailments to him? Can you not leave all your worry about all the diseases to him, all your fear and insecurity and anxiety about coronavirus to him? Thou shalt find that in the end he exceeds the skill of a million doctors. So, the doctor within, that is the divine or the soul, has skills which exceed those of a million doctors, but those skills will be manifested only if we follow yoga in its entirety, not just a few asanas and pranayamas. Now, here are two books which could help you in some of understanding some of these things. One is Back to Health Through Yoga, which is a Rupa Books publication and deals with the relationship between lifestyle and disease. And the other is Understanding Spirituality, which goes into deeper questions of spirituality in simplified language. Understanding Spirituality is a publication of Sri Aurobindo Ashram Delhi branch. Both these books are available in the bookshop of Sri Aurobindo Ashram Delhi branch. And you can order and they can be sent to you by courier. And they're also available online on Amazon and such platforms. If you have any questions or comments, of course, I have been told that the audience is allowed to ask questions. So you'll have a chance now. But if you still have some more questions or comments later, you can always contact me on email. The email address is rambij@gmail.com. Rambij kahe aapki marzi, Rambij kahe aapki marzi. RAM for Ramesh, BIJ for Bijlani. So, rambij@gmail.com. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for this beautiful talk and description on how yoga can be in a doctor and how we can reverse the diseases, lifestyle, mostly the lifestyle diseases. So many people joined us on Facebook, and there is a one question that has arisen from the Facebook, that how should one choose the object for meditation? Can it be same? Can it be some material object or anything else?
Actually, the techniques of meditation matter less than what we meditate upon and being clear about why we are meditating. So one can meditate upon an object like a picture, or some neutral object like a flower, or one can concentrate on a part of the body, or just concentrate on a sound. So the objects on which we concentrate are not really fixed. And depending upon the person's choice, again, a part of the body, whether it is between the eyebrows or it is in front of the heart, one can focus on any of these parts of the body. They're all equally good.
Yeah, okay, thank you, sir. So what do you suggest for the beginners who just wanted to start meditating? Because in beginning, it's difficult to focus or be attentive. And it took so long for some people to actually go into that state of real meditation. So what do you suggest that how beginners should start it?
Well, if you look at Patanjali's Yoga Sutras, they start with Yama and Niyama. And they are not a part of the technique of meditation. The meditation starts with the asana. You know, we sit in a particular posture during meditation. Now, they're not strictly speaking steps. It's not that only when one has perfected the yamas and niyamas, then only one can go to meditation. But the beginning has to be there. That is what these indicate. The beginning has to be made with yamas and niyamas, not with the meditative technique. And which means that we start with becoming a better person. And only if we do that, and our day is spent in a manner which is both peaceful, productive, and our conscience is clear, then one will find it easier to meditate. Then after that, the technique really doesn't matter, because Patanjali's scheme is extremely broad-minded. It doesn't tell us exactly how it is to be done. Assume a proper posture, then pranayama, go to slow breathing, then pratyahara, try to make a sensory withdrawal, that is, withdraw your attention from what is outside and inside both, and then dharana, concentrate. Patanjali doesn't definitely tell us to concentrate on what. And then dhyana, if you, after some stage in concentration, you find that your mind is going into thoughts related to the theme of concentration, even that is okay, which means both elements of concentration and mindfulness, both the elements are there in this. Broadly speaking, there are two types of techniques of meditation, concentration type and mindfulness type. Patanjali leaves scope for both, or a mixture of the two. And if it has been done properly with the right background of yama and niyama long enough, one day the person will also reach samadhi. So that is essentially what it is. Patanjali's scheme, that was perhaps one of the oldest, but yet that gives us the best sort of a summary of what the meditative process. No rigidity about technique, and yet there's some steps, some guidelines about the steps are there.
Okay, sir. So I want to know your views or your comments on how or does yoga really affect our cells or cellular level? What could be the possible mechanism that it can show its effect on molecular levels also? Because in lifestyle diseases, there are so many research papers, so many articles that shows that it can reverse or it can prevent lifestyle diseases. But what about its effect on molecular level or cellular level?
The effects on health and disease are mediated at the molecular level, because if you really look at it, there's no clear-cut separation between the body, life, and mind. So yoga is a mind-body approach. That is, it is using both the body and the mind to reach the deepest levels of the being. And the molecules in the body respond to it, because the molecules in the body are not the same as the molecules in a test tube. The molecules in the body are in an atmosphere of the life force, the prana. And therefore, these molecules respond to these impulses, they respond to that consciousness. In fact, to some extent, they have shown that even molecules in a test tube can respond to consciousness. And there are studies, you know, in which they find if you have an enzyme and a substrate in a test tube, and a person concentrates fully, tries to bring his consciousness fully on the test tube, and tries to increase or decrease the reaction velocity of the enzyme and the substrate. Now, if that then much more in a living body, which is charged with that prana, because the molecules are not showing it, but matter is also a manifestation of the divine. So it has the consciousness of the divine hidden in it. And therefore, the infinite intelligence of the divine resides in that molecule. When it is in a test tube, much less of that intelligence is manifested. When it is in the living body, a greater fraction of that intelligence is manifested. So the key is to harness that intelligence. And that is what yoga does. And that is why you find the molecular effects.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for joining us and sharing your beautiful thoughts and your knowledge. We are grateful, and thank you.
Thank you.